Good morning, children.
Here I am with class 10th, chapter 1, lecture 1. Okay, and the name of the chapter is Chemical Reactions and Equations. Okay, so in this we'll try to cover up the topics like what are chemical equations, balancing of chemical equations, heat changes accompanied during a chemical equation, combination reactions and decomposition reactions. Okay, cool. Come, let us start. What is a chemical reaction? Chemical reaction is a process where the original substance changes into a completely new substance with entirely different product. Okay, so a completely new substance is formed. And some examples of chemical reactions that you have already studied is cooking of food, rusting of iron, curdling of milk and burning of candle. So, in all of these, the original substance changes to a completely new substance. For example, when rusting of iron takes place, the gray metal iron gets converted into a reddish brown powder, iron oxide. Okay. Similarly, after curdling of milk, the white liquid milk forms a solid or semi-solid curd. Okay, and the taste also changes. So, completely new substance with different properties is formed after a chemical reaction. Now, let us study some terms related to chemical reactions like reactants. Reactant is the original substance which undergoes a chemical change. For example, in case of rusting of iron, iron is the reactant. Or in case of curdling of milk, milk is the reactant. So, reactant is the substance that we start with the reaction. Okay. Now, next is product. What is a product? Product is the new substance formed after a chemical change. And this is formed after breaking of the old bonds and formation of the new bonds. So, during product formation, a completely new substance has been formed. And this is formed when the reactant undergoes the rearrangement of atoms. Or I can say in the reactant, when the old bonds are broken and the new bonds are formed, a reactant is transformed into the product. Chemical reaction just involves rearrangement of atoms. This requires expenditure of energy, which can be in the form of heat, light or electricity. So, the energy which is involved in the chemical reaction can be in the form of heat, light or electricity. Now, come, let us study some of the chemical reactions. Here, what are we doing? I have made the diagram of a burner in which we are burning a magnesium ribbon. Now, before burning the magnesium ribbon should be cleaned with a sandpaper. Why do we need to rub it with a sandpaper? We need to rub it with a sandpaper so that the magnesium oxide layer which is formed on the magnesium ribbon, that is removed. Okay, so in order to remove the magnesium oxide layer, we have to rub it with a sandpaper. Now, this magnesium ribbon is burnt on the Bunsen burner with the help of a tongs. We hold it with the help of tongs. And the moment we burn it, a dazzling white light can be seen and the magnesium ribbon, gray magnesium ribbon, turns into a white powder. When we collect this white powder in a glass plate or a crucible, and then when we add this to a test tube containing 10 ml water and we stir it well, we get a solution of magnesium hydroxide. So, the reaction involved over here, you can see magnesium burns with oxygen to form magnesium oxide. Okay. And when this magnesium oxide reacts with water, magnesium hydroxide is formed. Now, there are two precautions that we need to take during this when we carry out this reaction in the laboratory. First, we should rub the magnesium ribbon with sandpaper. Secondly, the magnesium ribbon burns with a dazzling white flame and a lot of heat is also evolved. This heat and the flame may harm your eyes. So, we should maintain a proper distance from the burning magnesium ribbon. Okay, now coming on to the next reaction, you know it very well. The atmospheric gases also contain large fraction of nitrogen. Though nitrogen is inert in nature, but a very small fraction of nitrogen gas reacts with magnesium to form magnesium nitride, having the formula Mg3N2. When magnesium nitride is mixed with water, it is dissolved in water, it forms magnesium hydroxide having the formula MgOH2 and ammonia. This magnesium nitride is formed in traces. Why in traces? Because nitrogen, which is present over there in the atmosphere, it is inert. So very small quantity of nitrogen reacts. And the above mentioned reaction, as I said, it is highly exothermic in nature. Highly exothermic in nature means when you carry out this reaction, you can sense the large amount of heat which is given out or evolved during the reaction. Okay, and as a result, you can feel that heat. Now coming to the second type of reaction, reaction between lead nitrate and potassium iodide. Lead nitrate and potassium iodide, both of them are colorless aqueous solutions. That means they dissolve in water. We take lead nitrate solution in a test tube A, potassium iodide in a test tube B. Both of them are colorless. When both of them are mixed together in one test tube, when we pour the contents of A in test tube B, it is seen that the test tube B now has a yellow residue. Yellow residue means you can see some yellow colored solid particles settling down, and a colorless supernatant liquid or colorless liquid is present on the top part. This colorless liquid contains potassium nitrate having the formula KNO3, and this yellow residue is that of lead iodide having the formula PbI2. Now the color changes from colorless to yellow residue, and the reaction I have written over here, PbNO3 whole twice plus 2Ki gives PbI2. The yellow precipitate and 2KNO3. Okay, the third chemical reaction that you will be performing in the laboratory is reaction between zinc and dilute H2SO4. Here a test tube is clamped. It is put in the clamp stand or retort stand that is fitted with a rubber cork having a delivery tube. This test tube also contains around 6 to 7 mL of dilute H2SO4, and zinc metal is put in it. When zinc metal is put into it, you can see the colorless bubbles of a gas rising out very fast, which travel through this test tube, and it is evolved through this end of the delivery tube. Okay, when this colorless odorless gas is tested with a burning splinter, the splinter blows off with a pop sound. So this is the identification, this chemical test is the identification of hydrogen gas. Hydrogen gas can be tested with a burning splinter which blows off with a pop sound. And the reaction that zinc metal undergoes is zinc reacts with dilute H2SO4 to form ZnSO4 and hydrogen gas. ZnSO4 is nothing else but zinc sulfate, as you know. Now, you can see. And what happens over here? Here also the test tube, if touched with hand, you can feel it has become hot. So this reaction is also a exothermic reaction. That means heat is evolved during the chemical reaction. So the above chemical reactions can thus be identified. How do we identify that these are chemical reactions? They can be identified by some characteristics of chemical reactions. What are the characteristics of chemical reaction? First one is change in state of the reactant. That means when we are burning wax, wax is a solid, and after burning it, it gets converted into the gas. Similarly, when I had burned magnesium ribbon, magnesium was a solid, and after burning it changed into a powder. So what has happened? The change of state is occurring, and change of state shows the occurrence of a chemical reaction. Next is change in color. So when the magnesium ribbon is burnt, the gray metal magnesium gets converted into white powder. So there is a change in color. Similarly, rusting of iron, the gray iron metal is getting converted to reddish brown powder rust. So there's a change in color. Similarly, change in temperature is also seen. That means when we burn magnesium ribbon, heat is evolved. It is highly exothermic reaction. So heat is given out. Not every time, it may not be possible that heat is given out every time. Many a times heat is taken in or light is given out. So any change in temperature that is noticed shows that there's a chemical reaction occurring. Similarly, evolution of gas. So evolution of gas, whenever a chemical reaction is taking place, this is also many a times accompanied by evolution of some bubbles which may be colored or colorless, and that these bubbles are nothing else but gas. Example, reaction of zinc with dilute H2SO4 that I have just explained, there a colorless odorless gas hydrogen is evolved. So evolution of gas is also a characteristic of chemical change. Next, formation of precipitate. That means when the reactants are colorless solutions, aqueous solutions, and when we mix them, we get a yellow PPT, as in case of potassium nitrate, potassium iodide and lead nitrate. So when we start with colorless solutions and after the reaction we get a product which is a residue, that means, or a precipitate is formed. We can understand that a chemical reaction has occurred. Now, how do we symbolize, how do we represent a chemical reaction? Let us study about that. A chemical reaction can be represented by a chemical equation. What is a chemical equation? Chemical equation is the shortest way of representing a chemical reaction. Okay, that is the shortest way by in which we can tell everything about a chemical reaction. It is of two types, word equation and a symbolic equation. So what's a word equation? The word equation is the one where the reactants and the products are written in words, their names are written. For example, zinc plus sulfuric acid diluted forms zinc sulfate and hydrogen. Here zinc and sulfuric acid are the reactants and they form the products zinc sulfate and hydrogen. Since everything is written in form of word, we call it a word equation. The next one is, the second type of chemical equation is symbolic equation. Symbolic equation is more popular. This is generally used by most of us. So here what do? We write the, this is the shortest representation of a chemical reaction in terms of symbols and formulae of the reactants and the products. Here we make use of symbols and chemical formulae, and this is the most popular one. You'll find it everywhere in the books. Okay, so for writing the symbols and the formulae, it is very important that you have a very clear concept of the charges and the valencies so that you can write down the formulae correctly. Now let me give an example of a symbolic equation. Zinc, in the bracket I have written small s, which symbolizes solid, the state of zinc. It is a solid. When it reacts with dilute H2SO4, aqueous, AQ stands for aqueous, means H2SO4 is added to water. Aqueous is means we dissolve anything in water, we call it aqueous solution. So this is aqueous solution of dilute H2SO4 with water. When they react amongst themselves, the product is zinc sulfate, ZnSO4 aqueous. That means this zinc sulfate is water soluble, and hydrogen, in the bracket I have written small g, which means it is present in the gaseous state. So you can see it escaping out in the form of small bubbles. Now that we have studied about symbolic equation, we should know the importance of balancing a chemical equation. Why do we need to balance a chemical equation? Okay, equation in which the number of atoms of each element of the reactant is equal to the number of atoms of each element of the product. That means the number of atoms of each element on the reactant side is same as the number of atoms of each element on the product side. Such a reaction is known as balanced chemical equation. Okay, and why do we need to balance a chemical equation? We need to balance a chemical equation because balancing of chemical equation satisfies the law of conservation of mass. Fine, the universal law. it can be satisfied only when we have a balanced chemical equation. So in especially in inorganic chemistry, all the equations that we write should be balanced. Okay, now an unbalanced chemical equation doesn't obey the law of conservation of mass. Balancing, how do we do the balancing then? The balancing is done by hit and trial method. The name is hit and trial method. Here we keep on trying by placing different digits in front. Come, let us see how do we do the balancing. First, let us look at the reaction. Fe plus H2O forms Fe3O4 plus H2. That means iron with water, iron solid with water, which is gaseous, that is steam, it reacts to form triferic tetraoxide and hydrogen gas. Now this Fe3O4, it is a mixed oxide. It is a mixture of FeO, because iron never has the valency of 4. You know it very well. So it's a mixed oxide, mixture of FeO and Fe3O4. That means ferrous and ferric both. So the common name of this is ferrosferric oxide. Okay. Now let us see how do we balance it. The green symbols that are written, this is after the balancing. So before the balancing, let us see iron on the left hand side. That means on the reactant side, you know iron, how many atoms of iron is there? 1. Hydrogen, how many do we have? 2. Oxygen is 1. On the right hand side, that is the product side, number of iron atoms is 3. Number of oxygen atoms is 4. I've written over here, number of hydrogen atom is 2. Now when, according to conservation of mass, both the number of atoms on the left hand side should be equal to number of atoms on the right hand side. So in order to make it equal, what do I do? On the right hand side, we have 3 iron atoms. So I have multiplied 3 on the left hand side. Okay, 1 into 3 is equal to 3. And how can we multiply 3? We can multiply 3 by writing 3 in front of the iron on the reactant side in the chemical equation. Fine. Next, iron has been balanced. Moving on to hydrogen. Here the hydrogen is already balanced. Number of hydrogen atom was 2 on the left hand side. It was 2 on the right hand side also. So we don't need to balance it anymore. Now going on to oxygen. On the left hand side, oxygen atom is 1. On the right hand side, oxygen atom is 4. So we have to increase the number of oxygen atoms on the left hand side by multiplying it with 4. So 1 into 4 is equal to 4. Okay, now since I have multiplied it below, I have to write 4 over here. You have to be very careful when I am writing 4 in front of H2O. That means 4 into 2, 8 hydrogen atoms are there. 4 into 2, 8 hydrogen atoms are there on the left hand side. Now, how did I do it? 2 into 4, that makes 2 into 4 is 8 hydrogen atoms are there. What about oxygen? Oxygen on the left hand side was earlier 1. This 1 into 4 makes 4 now. So the number of oxygen has also changed and number of hydrogen has also changed. Now I have to change this hydrogen on the right hand side or the product side as well. So I have multiplied 2 at the lower part, you can see. And on the reaction, what do I do? I'll write 4 over here, so that 4 into 2 is 8. Now let us have a look again. Iron 3. Hydrogen atoms on the left hand side is 8. Hydrogen atom on the left hand side is 8. Right hand side is also 8. Oxygen on the left hand side is 4. Oxygen on the right hand side is 4. So now hence the equation is balanced. Okay. Now let us try out balancing with the second equation. CH4 gaseous, that is methane gaseous, plus oxygen O2, which is again a gas, forms CO2 carbon dioxide gas, and H2O, which is again a gas. Now if I write down the number of atoms on the left hand side, that is reactant side, carbon 1, hydrogen 4, oxygen 2. Right hand side, carbon 1, hydrogen 2, oxygen 3. Now since I have to balance it once again, let us see, carbon on the left hand side is same as the carbon on the right hand side, so I don't need to balance this. Hydrogen on the left hand side is 4, hydrogen on the right hand side is 2, so I have to multiply it with 2. That I can do by writing 2 in front of H2O. So this is done over here. Now next, oxygen here on the left hand side is 2, So since I have made this oxygen, let us see on the this right hand side, product side, this we already had two oxygens. 2 + 1 = 3 that I have written. Now since I have made this one 2 again, so that comes out to be total. How many oxygen atoms are there on the right hand side? 4. So in order to make this 4, I'll have to multiply this with this oxygen with 2. The oxygen on the reactant side should be multiplied with 2, and as a result I write 2 over here. So that, let us see once again. Carbon 1, carbon 1, hydrogen 4, hydrogen is 2 into 2, 4. Oxygen is 4, this oxygen is also 4, hence the equation is balanced. Third and the last one, which will help us to practice the balancing, you can see it very well. Magnesium nitride, Mg3N2 plus H2O gives MgOH, magnesium hydroxide, MgOH whole twice and NH3. The blue is the original equation which has been balanced with the red digits written in the red ink. Okay, you can see it very well. On the left hand side, we have 3 magnesium, 2 nitrogen, 2 hydrogen and 1 oxygen. Similarly, on the right hand side, we have 1 magnesium, 1 nitrogen, hydrogen we have 5. How 5? 2 into 1 is 2 plus 3. That means 5 hydrogen atoms and oxygen is 2. Now, in order to balance it, let us see. Magnesium on the left hand side is 3. But right hand side it is 1. So I have written 3 over here. Now it has become 3. Magnesium on the right hand side has also become 3. What about nitrogen? Nitrogen on the left hand side is 2. But nitrogen on the right hand side is only 1. So in order to make it 2, I have multiplied it with 2 and I have written 2 in the equation as well. Now what has happened? Since I have written 2 here in front of the nitrogen on the product side, what did I do to the number of hydrogen atoms? The number of hydrogen atoms has increased. It has become 2 into 3. That means 6. And what about the hydrogen atom over here? Since I have written 3 over here, so 3 into 2 is 6. So 6 plus 6 total, how many hydrogen atoms do I have on the right hand side? 12. But here the hydrogen atom was only 2 initially. I have to make it 12. So I am writing 6 over here. So 6 2s are 12. What about the oxygen atom? Oxygen atom was 1. Since I have written 6 over here, it has become 1 into 6, 6. What about the oxygen atom here? It was originally 2. And since I have written 3 in front of magnesium hydroxide, it has become 2 into 3, 6. Hence, the equation is balanced. Now, children, you can balance some of the equations which I have given over here. You can try out balancing. Okay? So, please do try out balancing. The more you practice, more expertise you will have. Now let us study about some of the heat changes during a chemical reaction. Okay, so a chemical reaction is characterized by some heat change also, I had said. Okay, which can be seen in the form of temperature fall or temperature rise. First type of chemical reaction according to the heat exchange is known as exothermic reaction. Exo means out, thermic means heat. So, a chemical reaction which is accompanied by evolution of heat or where heat is given out, such a reaction is known as exothermic reaction. This is a very popular reaction and it is used by us for most of the cooking of food, for running of vehicle, etc., etc. So, let us see some of the examples. Carbon solid when it is burnt, or coke solid when it is burnt in the presence of oxygen, gaseous, it forms carbon dioxide and heat is released, and this heat is used by us for various reactions, for various purposes. Similarly, this is the glucose, C6H12O6, glucose. When it is burnt in the presence of oxygen, it forms carbon dioxide, 6 molecules of carbon dioxide and 6 molecules of H2O, and plus heat. The plus heat many a times is written in the form of H heat or small delta, small triangle. So I am symbolizing heat in the form of small triangle. So you can see this is the above reaction that we have just done is a respiration reaction, and respiration is also a type of exothermic reaction. Why, children? Because during respiration the glucose is burnt or oxidized to provide us with energy. or it provides energy to the cells, and this energy can be used up in doing day-to-day activity. Similarly, burning of any gas, hydrocarbon like methane, when we burn this gas, we get carbon dioxide, water vapor and heat, and this heat is used to cook food. Okay, decomposition of vegetable matter by the microbes, this is also an example of exothermic reaction. Now coming on to, you must have noticed that here the heat is a part of product, and thus I have written delta sign on the product side. Okay, now endothermic reaction. Endo means taking in, going in. Thermic means heat. So a chemical reaction which proceeds by absorption of heat, that is known as endothermic reaction. It involves breaking, endothermic reactions generally involves breaking of old bonds which requires heat. And some of the examples of endothermic reactions are, the most easiest example I've chosen for you is heating of calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate, marble, is a solid when heated strongly. That means we are providing heat over here. I've added heat. It gives carbon dioxide and calcium oxide. Okay, this can also be written as calcium carbonate plus heat. That means heat is being absorbed to give calcium oxide and carbon dioxide. Similarly, nitrogen, when it reacts with 3 moles or 3 molecules of hydrogen at 500 degrees Celsius and 200 atmosphere iron molybdenum, it forms ammonia. Fine, so this is also endothermic reaction. Why? Because heat is absorbed over here. Similarly, heating of blue vitriol. Blue vitriol is nothing else but it is copper sulfate pentahydrate. 5 molecules of water, so pentahydrate. When this is heated, it forms a white colored salt, that is anhydrous copper sulfate, and water, 5 molecules of water is given out in the form of water vapor. Similarly, we can also utilize electricity. We can take in electricity, with the help of electricity we can bring about a chemical reaction like H2O, that means water, a liquid. When we pass electricity through H2O, we get the products as hydrogen gas and oxygen in the ratio 2:1. So here electricity is taken in, so this is, electricity is also a form of energy, so we say it's an endothermic reaction. Similarly, 6 molecules of carbon dioxide with 6 molecules of water in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll gives glucose, having the formula C6H12O6. Such a reaction where heat is taken, sunlight is taken in, not heat, sorry, where sunlight is taken in, or sunlight is carrying out the reaction, such a reaction is known as photochemical reaction. So photochemical reaction is the one where the reaction takes place in the presence of sunlight. One more photochemical reaction that you'll be studying is the decomposition of silver chloride. Silver chloride, having the formula AgCl, in the presence of sunlight, forms silver, a gray metal, and chlorine. Okay, so this is photochemical decomposition reaction. Fine. So children, the video has become quite long, I think. So I am shortening the video. Okay, so the decomposition reaction and the combination reactions we'll do in the next video. Till then, keep studying. Send me your feedbacks. If you have any doubt, please ask on the WhatsApp.
Comment.
And keep commenting to help so that I can improve on my video. Fine. Have a nice day, children. Bye-bye.